How much? 10 inches. And Michelle's texting me all concerned and nervous. We may not make it back for worship. But they ended up canceling the evening, I think, and let some of them come home earlier. But thank God that was down there. Chuck and I have had enough snow shoveling and plowing and blowing, and we're over it, aren't we, Chuck?
Well, stop, boy.
Well, welcome, everybody. It's good to have you with us. What a precious day. You know, we've got two weekends that are really important that we set aside in the Christian calendar, and it's Christmas and Easter. And the Palm Sunday, it ranks right up there. It's an important day. It's a day that was a defining moment for all mankind to have their lives forever changed. And you know, that's hard for us to wrap our minds around. We've got things really good, and things go pretty well for us. But that, without Jesus making an impact and being all those words we have on our impact sign up there, you and I would still be in a lost state today. And you know what? We can slip and fall, and he picks us right back up with his loving grace and brushes us off and lets us be valuable for the kingdom. Isn't it amazing he uses simple people like you and me to make a difference and impact in people's lives?
Yes.
How awesome. Maya, you want to come up, and she's got an announcement. I want to get the announcements out of the way so we can go through there it is.
No? Okay, there we go. Well, I made it back from Guatemala, just barely. That was announcing, but anyway, so April 4th, the youth group's going to go to Sky Zone, which is an indoor trampoline park. There is an increased risk of injury, so we will have waivers for the parents to sign. If your child wants to go, it's $30 for them, and we'll have pizza and drinks there. And I don't know what time we'll be leaving yet, but we'll have 90 minutes of jump time. So if you want to go, I need to know, and I need your parents' permission. And that's it.
So there may be a chance for Jesus to heal somebody.
Yes. Yes, there will.
All right. I had a couple people ask me this morning if it was too late to sing for next week for Easter. No, it's not too late. We're practicing after church today, so come. We'll be in that back room back there. Come on back, and we'll get ready for next week.
Cool. I'm excited for the choir. We're going to have Easter breakfast next week from 8 to 9:30. It isn't going to be a super involved breakfast. It's going to be nice, but it won't be majorly in depth with a lot of work. But we could use a couple people if you want to show up a little early and help serve and just visit with people and welcome. You know what? I'm going to expect this place to be over full next Sunday. And I would love for you, instead of coming in here and just sitting down, to mingle out there and talk to people. I need a couple people on the welcome center out there that the greeters can shuttle people to if they're new and not know anything about nursery or the Sunday school back here. I need you to just talk to people in Love Barn next Sunday. We may even need somebody out there in the lot if the lot gets full to park in the grass back here. Anywhere behind this church. If you're a member that's been here quite a while, especially you four-wheeler guys, park out there in the yard so people can have a nice, easy place to park out here. Also, we've got a ministry that's developed here in just the last month, and we are so thankful for it. We have several women, three or four at sometimes, that need picked up. And a couple of them are out here at the Carriage House. And Anna is out here at the Drake Terrace Apartments on Drake Road. And they need to be picked up at 9:30. And what an awesome ministry that is. Bob and Carolyn just went and picked them up. And they just got here a couple minutes ago because they tried to do it themselves this morning. So if somebody has the heart to love on somebody and see that they can come and hear the gospel of Jesus Christ, that we have an opportune time. Please come and see me, and we'll get you hooked up with their phone numbers, and you can go pick them up. They're waiting and ready. So what an awesome ministry. Well, have you come to worship Jesus this morning?
Yes.
Like I said, this is Palm Sunday. And Jesus is riding into Jerusalem, and he's forever going to change mankind's life. And I don't know about you, but I'm grateful. We've got something to praise God for and be thankful for. You know, a lot of us in the room are really going through some traumatic times right now, and we're going to talk about that in a little bit. But John 12:13 says, praise God. Blessings on the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hail to the King of Israel. That's part of our scripture we're going to read this morning. So praise God, they're saying. And hail to the King of Israel. And you know what? We have something to praise for this morning. It's so easy for us to take everything for granted. Church, we're so blessed. We're such a blessed nation. And I want us just to grab a hold of Jesus and let him just integrate every part of our being this morning. And the worship team's going to come up right now and lead us into worship. And I just want us to stand and sing with all our heart. Kids, show your moms and dads how to praise Jesus. I know you can do it. That's why we keep them in here with us, and then we'll dismiss them after worship is over. But we want the young people to be in here with their excitement, enthusiasm, and praise Jesus with us. So let's stand and praise God this morning.
Prince of
I'm going to make it.
Joyful this morning. This morning, I want to talk to us about Jesus' triumphal entry. It's an entry of success. Triumphal means success. You know, if you were Jesus and headed for death, you would look at success probably a little different than we've coined the phrase of being successful. But how many know that all things are possible through Christ Jesus who gives us strength?
Amen.
And Jesus, praise God, endured his destiny. The one chosen by the Father early on, the song we sang this morning is, he was here even before the beginning. What an amazing, amazing accomplishment that Jesus makes. Passover is one of the three feasts that the Jews attended in Jerusalem. And a lot of people gathered in Jerusalem to partake in the Passover feast. It's guesstimated that there were 50,000 people in Jerusalem. And when the Passover feast came, it tripled. There were over possibly 150,000 people in Jerusalem for this Passover feast. So when we hear and listen to the scriptures today that the streets were lined with people, oh my gosh. To put that in perspective, Kendallville is about 9,800. Fort Wayne, I think, is in the 250,000 range. I looked it up. It was like 253,000 people. So they're about 100,000 over what was in Jerusalem, if you can comprehend Fort Wayne. That many people have gathered for Passover. So it wasn't hard to draw a crowd. And you know, our God is so amazing and so intelligent that he knew that would be one of the most opportune times he would have to fully introduce himself to people. The chatters entered Jerusalem about Jesus and these miracles. He's just raised Lazarus from the dead. And we all know, those of us that study scripture, that Lazarus was dead for 4 days, and scripture said he stinketh. That guy was rotten to the core. And Jesus said, Lazarus, and he came to life. Now, anybody that could take a rotten body and bring it back to life with no ill effects would have to be God. I don't know about you, but I don't know any of y'all that could do that. And if you did, I'd really be scared. They wonder if he's going to show up for the feast. There's been a lot of chatter about Jesus, these miracles. And then we've got the Pharisees and the council, and they just hate him. I mean, they've plotted for almost a year to do him in. They have never seen such a crazy man in all their life. What a misconception about our Lord. The day before Mary anointed Jesus, and that caused a lot of trouble. It started with the disciples themselves. Judas, he ripped on Jesus for letting that woman waste a year's wages on his feet. And he says, you don't know what you're talking about. She did that to prepare me for my burial. What an amazing story. Mary anointed Jesus, and the news had traveled that Jesus is on his way. And with that expectation, they've lined the street. They've laid palm leaves and their cloaks down for the king. And you know what? Palm leaves weren't in the area, so that meant they intentionally went and cut palm leaves and brought them back. And I want us to take that at heart and be intentional about our faith with Jesus. Nothing happens by accident. Those people expected Jesus to show up, and they lined up. I was thinking about the parade we do at Christmas time, how we meet over here at Northside School, and people line the streets just to watch a goofy fire truck. And you know, as I sat and meditated on that, I thought, I wonder how big of a crowd we could draw if we said Jesus was coming to town. I put it on the sign out here this week. Jesus rode into town. And you know what? If he rode into town, it would be amazing to see the Christ followers and their reactions. Because we have no comprehension who Jesus is, even though we've read and studied and learned about him. Many in Jerusalem are mad and are upset. Jesus threatens our power and authority. And you know what? We get in that state ourselves as human beings. Threatened at work, threatened at school, threatened by a family member. We just get threatened from all sides. This couple days were to be spent cleansing themselves for Passover. These people have grouped to get themselves clean. And how did it work out? Here they are plotting to kill the Savior. And that just goes to show you, church, all the more that we can't prepare to cleanse ourselves without Christ Jesus. We can try and try and try, and it just won't work. Instead, they plan to kill our Savior, and now they want to kill Lazarus because Lazarus is alive and he's part of the miracle. So we'll just get rid of anything that's left of the miracle. So many people today see Jesus as a threat to them as well. Do you know anybody that you've tried to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with and they just shut off like a light switch? They're threatened. It's what they've done. It's what they might do. It's what they might have to give up. It might be what they can't do anymore. We might have to get rid of some friends and change our ways. And they don't want that threat of Jesus. One translation tells us, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna there means to save or keep safe. They're yelling, save us. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. The crowd knows Psalm 118, verses 25 and 26. It's what they're quoting. You have that up there, Patrick? We've got a new guy on board back there, and bless his heart, he is doing a good job today. He's not late, he's on time. It says, please, Lord, save us. Please, Lord, please give us success. Bless the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. Isn't that amazing that he's almost begging, please, please, please save us. I don't know about you, but I've begged several times for Jesus just to step in and help me. I was between a rock and a hard place, and I needed him to show up. And church, we've got to be careful and not use Jesus as a Santa Claus. Only need him. Only say, please, Lord, please, 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 when we got our backs against the wall. We need to be thankful and praise him because he's Lord God Almighty. The crowd looks for a king to save them. I just want to fast forward a little bit to 2018. Our land continually looks for a savior to come today. Someone to turn this mess around. And you know what? We've adopted that time to cry out to the Savior, and it's called election. We count on a president to save us. Messes have been on earth since Adam, and the more people, the more the mess. Can you agree it's getting messier all the time? We as a nation need our guns protected. We need sex abuse stopped. We need our national debt curbed. We need teachers carrying guns. Our Social Security needs replenished. There's old people like me that just are really concerned. And on and on and on. We could go on for hours with what this country needs right now. And church, I want to tell you, we need Jesus.
Amen.
We need a Savior. We know the scripture, God so loved the world that he sent his Son. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Listen to why Jesus came. We've got it in Matthew 1, verse 21. It's our Christmas story. And you know what? We can't have Christmas without Easter. We can't have Easter without Christmas. We can't have either one of them without the cross. Matthew 1, 21. It says, he's talking to Mary. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be very great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David, and he will reign over Israel forever. His kingdom will have no end. Church, Jesus is forever. And the scripture that says he's going to reign over all of Israel, over the throne, Jesus is riding into that place on a donkey.
Hallelujah.
Right now. And Kyle got to help me out. Every year I want him to bring a little donkey in here. We're going to have Jesus right in this place. And all we do is talk about it. Next year, we got to make it happen. It'll work. Jesus forever, church. He's forever. When God gives you the throne, it's yours. Jesus is king, and he's given him the throne. Jesus rides into town to take his authority and to give you and me life, and it's going to cost him his pretty shortly here. Jesus is not a threat to the earthly kingdom, but to the Savior. He's the Savior of our souls. He's not a threat to the people that are worried about him. He had no intention of ruling this land. The authority had already been turned over to Satan till he comes back again. He's coming, church, and we're going to be with him. They watch and wait for their king to appear on a white horse. A real leader rides in on a white horse. I've shared with you before, I used to tell the kids, they'd ask, are there animals in heaven? And I'd say, no. They don't have any souls, kids. There's no animals in heaven. And then I got to reading about the white horse and Jesus riding it and you and me on him too. And I thought, you know what? I better rethink all this. Because there are animals in heaven. They're looking for this ruler to ride in on this big white stallion and be more powerful than anything they've ever experienced. He has confidence. He has perseverance. He can take you out in a nanosecond. He's a commander, a ruler. He's a peacemaker by force. That's who they're looking for. And somebody yells, wait a minute, is that Jesus on a donkey? Are you serious? Not who I was looking for. How many of you all looked for something that you thought was powerful and you expected it so bad to find out that you missed the mark totally? There are thousands of people lined the street looking for Jesus to come on a white horse, and he shows up meek and lowly on a donkey. And Jesus has them get this donkey, a foal that isn't even broken. That's how good our Jesus is. He jumped on that donkey's back, and that donkey was as peaceful as could be. It doesn't matter how unbroken we are or how broken we are. Jesus can give us peace, church. It's him and him only that can do it. The high priests and the Pharisees are afraid, and now the crowd fears. And church, when fear sets in you and me, it is destruction. It's a spirit from Satan. Scripture says, I didn't give you a spirit of fear. I gave you a spirit of power, love, and a sound mind. And they feared that they were going to lose their authority and their power when they saw Jesus coming. Verse 15 says, don't be afraid, people of Jerusalem. Look, your king is coming, riding on a donkey's colt. And you know what, church? Only the believers heard that statement that day. Scripture, so many places and times, tells us, he who hath an ear, let him hear. And the Lord spoke to that crowd, thousands of people that day, and there were only a few Christ followers that heard that message. Fear not, for I'm with thee. There's a point in life where we realize our spiritual life is more important than our physical life. I got to a place in my life, and it took me way too long, church, to figure out that it isn't about this body. Yeah. It's about where this body's spirit spends eternity.
Right.
We are overcomers. We're victors. No matter what happens to us, we win. It's a win-win, church, with Jesus. And without him, our physical body is all we have. And we better enjoy this mess while we're here. Because when it's over, it's over. Jesus said, I wish you were one as the Father and I are one. Unity. He wants us in unity, church. Jesus rode into Jerusalem that morning to create a unity in his people, his followers. Palm Sunday affected my life in 1965 in a major way. It wasn't really that spiritual moment that took me out of the physical, because I was only 14 years old at the time. Oh my gosh, that was eons ago. But as a child, I never went to church. We just didn't go to church. My mom and dad were good people. They were moral people. But we didn't go to church. And I remember in 1965, a tornado on Palm Sunday strike in this area. It struck state after state. A stillness came like you've never experienced, and it was hard to breathe. I don't know if any of you have ever been pre-tornado, but I'm going to tell you something. It gets so deathly quiet, and that air is so heavy, you can't hardly breathe. And soon it became dark gray and violent. Tornadoes struck the land from Iowa to Indiana. 47 of them hit, and it killed 271 total. 137 in Indiana alone. And I thought, in my simple mind of religious people and God, how could a good God allow something like that to happen to those people? Have you ever thought that or heard that yourself? It's amazing what went on that day. April 11th, 1965, that tragic tornado hit Shipshewana. And it was a religious community devastated. And I wondered, how could that happen to such a people? We used to go up there on Sunday because we didn't go to church and just drive through the area, Topeka and Shipshewana, and you would see those girls and guys riding their bicycles. There weren't a lot of cars and semis and mobile homes going down the road, so they could ride at leisure. And there was something about that. You could watch that group of people. They always had to wave at you. They didn't know who you were, but they waved. And it was just beautiful to watch it. And not knowing anything about God, there was something about their presence that you knew was special. And I'm thinking, how could a good God allow that to happen to them? I ran across these two testimonies. I've got it from Shipshewana. I looked up to see how many people were killed, and I ran across this. It says, several people shared their stories from that day, including Eugene Bontrager, who lost both his parents when he was just 20 years old. However, he and the residents who survived that day used the tragedy as a positive today. Isn't it crazy? They're using it as a positive yet today. I thought of Romans 8:28. God can take all the bad things and turn them to good if we just love Him and we're called to His purpose, church. It helped me not make problems mountainous, Bontrager said. How many of us take our problems and take a molehill and turn it into a mountain? Can't we get in our little pity party and moan and groan and cry in our beer and just get all upset? It helped me not make problems mountainous. Everybody has a story. If we started over here with Nancy and Earl and went around the room, every one of us in this room has a story, church. And it's your story. It affected your heart and your family in a most special way because it's your story. Everybody that's left, that's old enough to experience that tornado, has a story about that day. And you and I have a story. His name's Jesus. And we're responsible to tell that story to whomever will listen. If we can learn from it and not be woe is me and pick ourselves up. He's saying pick yourself up no matter what you've done. Pick yourself up and live in the grace of Jesus Christ. There are some people in this room that have been through some pretty serious stuff. And you're going through some pretty serious stuff right now. And it's only by the grace of Jesus that we can sit here and keep on keeping on, church. He says, but we need each other. We're in a dispensation of the church that we don't really think we need each other anymore. We're in a culture, in a land where we don't need each other anymore. I owe, so it's off to work I go, and when I get home, I click my garage door, and it opens, and I drive in and shut it, and I don't really worry about you. And we have never been in a time that we haven't needed each other more than we need each other right now. Then he closes by saying, we can't do it alone. We can. Doesn't work too good. Our job is not to forsake the assembly, to meet together, to pray one for another, to confess one to another, and to build each other up. That's our job. While the event was 53 years ago, it has created a sense of togetherness for the community that still shines through today. We're all so close, Roberta Markley, president of Shipshewana Area Historical Society, said. All of the churches are one. There's probably 7 or 8 in the area, but we're all one. Church, we got to become one again. Don't let a tragedy have to come your way to become one in Christ Jesus. Jesus rode into town so we could have Ephesians 4:5 happen. It says there is one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God, and Father of all, who is over all, in all, and living through all. That's why Jesus came. Because we had lost that. When Adam and Eve sinned in the garden, it was gone forever until the Savior came. And they're all gathered for Passover. And you know what? Jesus is going to pay the price. He's going to do it once and for all. He's going to shed his body and blood, and it never will have to be done again. If only the people could have grabbed a hold of that. Jesus rode into town. People, thousands lined the street, and now they have to make a choice. Will we follow Jesus or man? Because they're getting from both sides. There are believers there, and there are haters there. A house divided cannot stand, can it?
No.
Jesus is about to experience the ultimate discomfort, and it's called death. For you, for me, for all his people. The crowd shouted, help, save. But they bailed on their witness. I was thinking of Peter when I wrote that, how, Lord, we'll never leave you. And what did he do? Forsaking. Not only once, but 3 different times. Judas has walked with him for 3 years. He's disloyal, ends up committing suicide. And the other disciples, we're going to see pretty quick, they just run and hide and lock themselves in a room. The Church Universal is doing that to Jesus again. I want to ask us, what is it you need help with today? Do you need help with an unruly kid? How about a wife or a husband? Anybody having finances messed up? We've all got needs, don't we, church? There's one that came to help us all. What is it you need saved from? Any of you got that nasty little snot standing beside you at work? Lord, help me. How about addiction of some sort or another? Mikey's got an eating addiction I could use some help with. Every one of us needed saved from ourselves, church. You know what? We blame Satan way too much. We give that sucker way too much ground because it's my own will that gets me in trouble. I just allow him a foothold. What is it we need saved from? Verbal abuse? it just goes on and on and on. Pornography, there's just one thing after another we all need saved from. The news of this nation is scary, church. Some days our King doesn't shine bright. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
He's not light in the darkness. And what is hypocritical is somebody claiming to be Christian and then doing unchristian things. You know what? That gives a license to live like hell every day. Because if he's Christian and can do that, I can too. Bad, bad scene. We laugh at Russia. They've infiltrated every part of our being. We mock China, the country we owe $1.6 trillion to. Pitch old North Korea in the mix. We're worried about North Korea and their missiles. You know what? Russia is three times more powerful than they are. Jesus is riding into town today to pay a debt he didn't owe for the people, a debt we could never pay on our own, church. We can elect officials, we can trust in man, and we're going to get let down every time.
Right.
Every time, sooner or later. We're not lining the streets this morning. We're all sitting here in God's presence. What a beautiful scene that we're here and the Holy Spirit's here and we're safe here. Some of us need to get serious with ourselves. Jesus wasn't an earthly king. Earthly kings come and go, and Jesus never leaves his church. We've heard the scripture already. And to reconfirm it, we've got Matthew 28, 20b, the last half of the verse. And be sure of this, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age. Church, we got a buddy that'll stick to us closer than a brother, and his name's Jesus. He's a breath away. He's 18 inches from our mouth, and all we have to do is say Jesus. And he hears us. I don't know about you, but I need Jesus really bad. He rode into my life. He chose me. I didn't choose him. I love the song we sang this morning. Jesus is calling you today. And I want to ask you a question. Are you saved? You know, some of us maybe have been playing the game for 2, 3, 5, 10, 20, 30, 50 years. It's not a game, church. It's real. It's the real deal. Only you can answer, are you saved? Do you like Jesus' miracles or do you love Jesus as your Savior? Not for what he does, but for who he is. See, there are people lying down the streets because he brought a dead man to life. And that dead man, Mary and Martha said, Lord, if you'd only been here. And Jesus wept. Remember that? It says he wept. You know, I was thinking and praying about that, and I thought, you know what? Jesus knew the rest of the story before he brought him back to life. He was gone. He was with the Lord, and Jesus brought him back so he could be threatened right now to get killed while he's getting killed. The full picture always comes. The circle always meets where it started, church. And we never know why God is doing something in our lives for the reason he's doing it, because he's so bigger and greater than us. He sees it all, and all we can do is put God in our little box and have him be who we want him to be, and he's so much more than that. He He already had taken Lazarus' life by not showing up and letting him pass a normal death. And now he's back here going to suffer along with Jesus. God so loved you that he sent his son. I thought of John 3:16-18. And I did it out of the Message Bible. The Message Bible isn't used often. In fact, Pat didn't even have it in Easy Worship. He had to do some work for me to get this. This is how much God loved the world. He gave his son, his one and only son. And this is why. So that no one need be destroyed. By believing in him, anyone can have a whole and lasting life. God didn't go to all the trouble of sending his son merely to point an accusing finger, telling the world how bad it is. Don't you hate it when people tell you how bad you are? God sent the law down, church, and it made people mad. They didn't like it. The law doesn't save us. Only Jesus saves us. He came to help to put the world right again. Anyone who trusts in him is acquitted. Anyone who refuses to trust in him has long since been under the death sentence. Without knowing it. Church, without Jesus, we're dead in our tracks. To bring up Shift You On again, I've shared it before. Remember Six Mile Corner Restaurant where the real sharp curve was? They had a sign out there for years, do not be caught dead without Jesus. Anybody remember seeing that? Did you read it? Yeah, there's hands going up. I'm not the only old one in here. And why? Because of that person's failure to believe in the one-of-a-kind Son of God when introduced to him. There are people all over the place that refuse to believe in Jesus, church. Not my problem, not your problem. Our problem is to share the gospel with whomever will listen. Because God so loved the world that he sent his son. Is anyone here this morning under death? Have you failed to believe in Jesus? Jesus is writing into your life right now, coming into your presence, church. The scripture tells us, today is the day of salvation. We don't know if we have tomorrow. I can't even tell you if I've got 5 minutes. Chuck and Val, you guys want to come up? Jesus didn't write into your life to make you comfortable, church. He came to make your life eternal. It's where do you go from that physical to the spiritual? That's all that matters. To live forever in heaven with him. He didn't come to tell you how bad you are. There's not a person in this room that doesn't know how bad you are. Not a one. Does that make us bad? No, it makes us human. And we needed a God to step up and save us. He came to tell you how much he loves you. He came to tell you he suffered in your place and you owe him nothing. All he wants you to do is believe he is Lord and King of Kings. We've all fallen short and sinned, every one of us in this room. We know the wages of sin is death. A lot of the things you and I do back in biblical times, we'd have been stoned to death. They'd have got rid of Mike in a hurry. God sent Jesus to die for us while we were still sinners. Have you ever been in a church that says, well, clean yourself up and come back and we'll talk to you? We're fishers of men, church. We fish for men and we catch them. And then when we catch them, Jesus will clean them. We don't clean them first and then say, oh, man, you fit in with us pretty cool. Not the way it works. If the church is doing what it's supposed to do, we have dirty people around us. Praise God. We've got hypocrites around us. Can you imagine that? Ain't coming to your church, Mike. You got a bunch of hypocrites over there. I just tell them, where are they supposed to be? We're all getting healed together. I remember Tyrone standing up here one Sunday preaching. He mentioned he was black, and I yelled out, I didn't know you were black. We all look the same, church. We're sinners saved by grace. We've been saved by grace, not by works. There's not a one of you in this room right now that can work hard enough, fast enough, save yourself. Not a one. Not a one. You'll get so tired, you'll just fall down and faint. We're saved if we believe Jesus died in our place. He was buried and rose again. If you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth, Romans says, that Jesus died, was buried, and resurrected, you shall be saved. It's our Easter message. I'm going to let Chuck and Val sing. I don't even know what they're going to play. I just know that it's God anointed and appointed. And they're going to sing. And I want all of you to sit here and think where your spiritual state is. I'm not going to ask you to come up here and grab the microphone and share your mess. Jesus said, I didn't come to make you look like an idiot. I came to make you look like a king. You're my sons, you're my daughters. But I know the words they're going to sing are going to be anointed and appointed, and I want you to listen to them. If there's something in your heart, in your mind, in your spirit that needs to change, today is the day of salvation, church. Tomorrow may never come. You don't want to be caught dead without Jesus.
He leads me beside the still waters, and he gives the greenest pastures for my bed. He restores my soul in a world that gets so cold, and sometimes he pours oil on
beautiful song. The Lord is my shepherd, and I'm his lamb. Are you Christ's lamb this morning? You know, he loved us so much, church, that when one of us strayed, he would go after that lamb. And you know what Jesus did? What the shepherds did? They picked that little lamb up and broke its leg and put it around their neck and carried it home. Broke that leg so that little lamb wouldn't stray again. It's a symbol of Jesus breaking our bondage, our sin nature. Everything that we need, Jesus has paid for, church. If you're here this morning and you've never accepted Jesus, I want you not to leave here unsaved. You leave here as a lamb of the shepherd Jesus. And if you're not sure, just rededicate yourself. You know what? You only need to be saved once. But there are times that Satan just grabs a hold of us and pulls us and pulls us until we just get out of his saving grace. And you know what? When we're in Christ Jesus and we slip and fall, Scripture says in Romans 8:1, there's now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. You're not condemned to die. You can live in Jesus' grace, but he expects you to go and sin no more. Don't do that mess over again. I want us to bow our heads. I'm not going to have anybody stand up or make a big commotion or a scene. Jesus said, I didn't come to shame you. I didn't come to condemn you. I didn't come to embarrass you. I just came for you so you could have life and have it abundantly. If you're here this morning and you feel in your heart and in your spirit that you have never accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior, I want you to slip your hand up right now. If you're here and you need to rededicate your life, if you feel you could just do a little bit better for Jesus, showing, raise your hand. Oh my gosh, we've got hands everywhere. And if you're looking at me, mine's up. Church, it's time to step up and be the church. We've counted on Obama. We've counted on Trump. We've counted on the Bushes. We've counted and counted and counted. We counted on George Washington. We counted on all kinds of people. And look at the mess we're in. Jesus is going to take us out, church. He's going to call us home, and we're going to be with him, and he is going to let us come back and rule and reign with him, and we're going to even judge the angels. That's how much authority and power we're going to have in Christ Jesus. It's Palm Sunday. Jesus rode into town for you and me. And he's got a hornet's nest stirred. And I mean, things are going to start to rock and roll pretty quick. And they're not going to be cute. Jesus paid the price for you and me. And he loves you right where you're at, church. He loves you. There is nothing that can separate you from the love of God. Nothing. going to be doesn't like your sin. We got to shape up, church. It's time. The world needs us so desperately. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus this morning. Lord, I didn't see any hands for salvation, and that's good. Unless somebody is afraid to raise their hand. And Lord, you know their heart. You don't look at our outward appearance. You look at the heart. You know what's inside of us, every bit of our being. You understand and you know us. So, Lord, I'm asking you to touch that heart. If you are here and you were concerned to raise your hand, I just want you to ask Jesus to come into your heart and rule and reign to be Lord of your life. Surrender everything that you are to Him and let Him just lead and guide you in truth, because everything He tells you will be true. He's your strength when you don't have any. He's your peace when you're afraid. He's a sound mind when you begin to doubt. He's your healer when you begin to hurt. Lord Jesus, save them. And Lord, there are people in here that just raised their hands all over the place that want to rededicate to you this morning. What an awesome sight. Because, Lord, that means they're surrendering. They're asking you to come in and take control of their life that they've lost control of, maybe. Oh, Lord, we thank you so much that there's no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. That you love us with all your heart. Lord, there are people outside these walls that need to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. We need to be one church. We need to be of one heart, one mind, one baptism. Lord, there are 20 some churches in Kendallville, and they need to hear that message, because there are very few of us in unity, very few of us that really actually love one another. And Lord, that is a crying shame, because we all have the same good news to share with your sons and your daughters. Lord, this world desperately needs us. That last person has to hear how good and great you are and your savior of their life before you can come back on that white horse that they so expected that day to see you riding in on. Lord, let's be quick and be busy about your business. And that can happen. We can just be in heaven running, skipping, singing. Lord, we can just be having a blast up there. But it takes that last person to know who you are. And only you know who he or she is. Lord, we thank you for prophecy. We thank you that the most of it, the bulk of it, has been fulfilled. We look for your return soon. And Lord, that's why our hearts burn and ache and cry out for salvation for those that don't know you. Lord, my heart breaks for those that don't know you yet. But it breaks even more for those that have claimed to know you and have fallen away. Lord, just touch every person in this room today. And Lord, I'm asking you in Jesus' name, because anything I ask in Jesus' name will be given, that you would lay a burden on every person's heart in here to invite somebody that doesn't know Jesus. Lord, they need you. And that one special person can hear an invite from their friend or a coworker and just accept the offer. Lord, it's not about filling the chairs. It's about filling the kingdom. We want our family and our friends to live in eternity with us forever and ever. That's our goal. It's your goal. That's why you rode into town today, was to set people free, to let people know that you were God, to let people know that you were telling the truth about everything you said. Lord, the world cries for truth. And you are the way, the truth, and the life. And we all know that no one comes to the Father except by you. Thank you for being faithful and riding into town to get that hornet's nest stirred up that will eventually kill you for our sake. Lord, help us to never take that for granted. We love you and bless you and praise you. And we ask you to save those that aren't saved yet. And we do it in Jesus' name. Everybody say amen. Amen. We're going to have some elders up here, and if you have any special need, we want you to come up and be prayed for. We just love you, and we want you to be made whole. So you can leave here and cause somebody else to want what you have. So if you have a need, come up here and let them pray. They're faithful to do that for you. Go with God. He loves you. So do we.
Sorry.